Glad you've all joined us for the session, Administering Your Enterprise Geodatabase Using Python. Jill and I are product engineers in the geodatabase team out of Redlands. Jill is the Python GP person, and you will discover that as she does her demos. Show of hands, how many of you are still administering your geodatabase using desktop? Majority. Anyone transitioning into Pro? Okay, a few, that's good. So from today's demo and this session, I hope your takeaway is that all your workflows that used to happen with desktop can be transitioned over to Pro using Python. And most of the scripts that Jill is showing will work with both desktop and Pro with slight changes because desktop used Python 2.7 and Pro uses 3.6. As we prepared for this session, we did make some assumptions. You have basic knowledge of Python, and you're here to get some more new tips and tricks from us. You know what a geodatabase is, and you have some knowledge of how the geodatabase stores data and does transactions. And you're here for the code. The slides and the demo will be shared. So just sit back, take in all this information, and we will send you away with some with all the things that are presented here. We will talk about the types of administrative roles, which is there in many organizations. They are different individuals, but in many, it's all rolled into one. Anyone here wearing multiple hats? Most of us, yes, us, we included. Creating enterprise geodatabases, users, roles, applying permissions to data so that other users can access that data. Then we'll switch gears and talk about version management. What is our role as administrators? The reconcile process, compress, and there's a lot of demos through each of these sections. Python is the platform of choice since scripts can be built agnostic of platform. So all the scripts we show today can be run both on Windows, Linux, server, desktop with minimal changes for each of those environments. And within Python, you can take advantage of programming logic like looping or cursors. You can also integrate third-party functions, which you will see Jill do in her demo. It's also a great way to automate your workflows, which is why it is one of the most preferred languages among administrators. ArcGIS Pro now comes bundled with Jupyter Notebooks that allows you to create and share your documents that contain live Python code. We got a glimpse into the future of notebooks at the plenary where they showed us ArcGIS Notebooks. Jill will be using both these powerful tools, Python and Jupyter, in her demos. When we talk about geodatabase, we talk about two distinct set of tables. The first is the geodatabase system tables, or what we call repository tables, which contains metadata about your data. And it also stores information that is maintained at the workspace level, which then applies to all the data sets within your workspace, like version, domains, etc. Some of the administrative operations you do on those is the geodatabase upgrade, managing your connections, and also version management. The second type of tables are the user-defined tables. This is what we usually see when we connect to an enterprise geodatabase. You can have both tabular data, feature classes, or other dataset types. The administration operations on this data, this usually changes the state or the structure of the data, right? Like adding fields, deleting fields, renaming fields, also granting, revoking privileges, and then adding any geodatabase behavior, like enabling editor tracking, archiving. These are all the things that you as a data administrator do. It is kind of end of the day, so we kind of thought of putting color so you can track with us as we talk about these three different roles. The database administrator, geodatabase administrator, data owner, also known as data set administrator. The database administrator, right, we're just talking about the profile of each of these people, is the person responsible for the instance level administration. They are the ones who do the install of the database platform, creating the database, database backup, and performance monitoring is something they do as part of their role. But one of the takeaways from this session is that you need to work in collaboration with all the other administrators to maintain a performance system. The geodatabase administrator is the user that owns all the repository tables. And because they own these tables, they have some additional privileges in a geodatabase. They can edit any data that is registered as versioned. They can view and reconcile any version. They can also change properties of a version owned by other users. And they are also the ones that perform the compress operation. The data set owner administrator is a person who loads the loads data into a geodatabase. You can see that they're also the person who modifies the schema of the underlying table and also enable geodatabase behavior on the data that is stored. So let's talk about administrative workflows that are performed by a database administrative user. There are two ways to create an enterprise geodatabase. First is if you're starting from scratch and you do not have a spatial database in your setup, you can use the Create Enterprise Geoprocessing tool to create a brand new geodatabase. Or you have the test environment and a production environment, you can use this tool to automate creation of enterprise geodatabase. It is the database administrator who needs to run this tool because you need additional privileges to create that underlying database. And only then we go and install our repository tables in it. The second way of creating the geodatabase is by enabling, using the Enable Enterprise Geodatabase tool, which can be used where you already have a spatial database in-house, where you have all your data users. But now you're come to a place where you want to use geodatabase functionality. That is where you can run the Enable Enterprise Geodatabase tool. And that tool now can be run by the geodatabase administrator. You don't need that elevated privilege because you already have the database present. So once you have your geodatabase created, you're probably going to want to create users so they can access the geodatabase and create data. Most of the database administrators would be more comfortable creating their users directly in the database. But if there is a case where you want to create these users from the client, we have a tool for you, and that is the Create Database User tool. This tool will create users with the appropriate privileges, and the link I have shared here in the slide will give you details on what each of these users get. The tool supports both operating system and database users. One thing this tool will not create is the geodatabase administrative user. You cannot use this tool to create that user because the geodatabase administrative user requires slightly elevated privileges than the rest of the clan. So going right into this creating users, right, we also want to talk about creating database roles. Creating database roles makes it really easy to assign and revoke privileges to a number of users at a time. So rather than iterating through all and assigning privileges to each of the individual users, you can create a group of those users into roles and apply privileges at the role level, and that trickles into all the what each user gets. We would recommend creating roles first as you're creating, so that when new users are created, you can just add them to the role and they will inherit the appropriate privileges. Again, this will be done by the database administrator. Let's see a quick demo from Jill now about this database administrative workflows. Handing it to Jill.
Thanks, Annie. That was a lot of info to take in the first part. Now we're gonna get into some demos. So if you guys read the plenary, I'm sure you guys saw Jupyter Notebooks already. It comes with your installation of ArcGIS Pro, and these are executable documents that contain both computer programming code as well as rich text elements. So for any of you that have not done any geodatabase admin workflows before, I'm gonna start off with some basic things and then we'll build onto it from there. So the first thing that we're gonna do is we're gonna create an enterprise geodatabase. So first I'm importing my modules and setting some variables. I'm gonna go ahead and get our tool running and then I'll go over those. So we're gonna run the create enterprise geodatabase tool. And what we're passing in is we're passing in a few different variables. So we have our platform, so we're gonna be creating a geodatabase on SQL Server. I provide the instance name, I give the database a name. In this case, I'm using operating system authentication as my DBA credentials. So it's going to use my Windows login information. And that way I don't need to provide a database admin username or password. I'm choosing to use the SDE schema, that meaning that my SDE user is going to own those repository tables. Next, I'm going to provide the geodatabase admin username and a password. I could optionally provide a table space. It's not needed for SQL Server, but if you have Oracle or Postgres and you have a table space already created, you could use that. And I'm providing my authorization file. So I'm just passing these variables into the tool, and we've let the tool run. So since I'm using ArcPy get messages, we can see what happened when the tool ran. So it ran successfully. It checked those privileges to make sure that I had the elevated privileges to create a database. It created the database, it created the geodatabase admin user, it validated the authorization file, did a few SQL Server type things, and then finished creating the geodatabase schema. So now that we've created our geodatabase, let's go ahead and create a connection. So we're going to create a connection as the DBA user, so those same Windows credentials. I'm going to use the create database connection tool. I need to provide an output location, a name for the SDE file, and I'm going to save my credentials. So again, I'm just passing in my Windows credentials and connecting to the database we just created. So as that runs, we can see it was successful. So if any of you have ever connected to an enterprise geodatabase before, I'm sure you've used these SDE connection files to do so. So now that we have our connection, let's go ahead and create a role. We're going to use the create role tool. We're going to pass in our DBA credentials, so that SDE connection file we just created, and we're going to create a role named editor. So that role was created. Now let's create some users and assign them to that editor role. So in this case, since I want to create multiple users at one time, I'm using a Python dictionary. This way I can have my username and my passwords can be different. In this case, they're the same just for simplicity. So now we have our dictionary. Let's loop through that dictionary. We're going to use the create database user tool. We're going to pass in our DBA credentials. We're creating database users, our username and password, and we're going to assign them to that editor role. So we've created three users, Tom, Matt, and Colin. If we want to take a look in SQL Server Management Studio, we should see our database is created. Dev Summit Demo 1, and let's take a look at our roles. We can see our editor role has been created, and we have users Colin, Matt, and Tom in there. Back to Annie.
All right. Everybody seeing my screen?
All right, let's switch gears and now talk about administrative workflows that are performed by a dataset admin user. So once you've created your enterprise geodatabase, you're going to start wanting to load data into that. We have numerous tools for creating data in your geodatabase. You're probably most familiar with them. They all start with the word create. But as listed in the slides, we also have other tools for loading data. When you use these loading tools, you will need to be the data owner of the data that you're loading. Once it's loaded, now you want to manage privileges on your data to determine who can access this data. You do this by using the Change Privileges tool, which will take a list of data sets and allow you to grant or revoke either view or edit privileges on that data. So when you select view, when you get view privilege, you can select the contents of the data. When you get edit, you can insert, update, or delete contents of that data. You must be connected as the data owner to grant these privileges to other users. That was a short break for Jill. Now back to her to give us a comprehensive demo of these two administrative roles.
Okay, so for this demo, I've already created a Python script to execute a number of tasks. Before getting started, I want to mention the program I have opened. This is Wing. It's just the IDE that I happen to prefer to use to debug my Python scripts. But this script could be run in any other development environment or idle, whatever you prefer. So in this script, we're going to create a new enterprise geodatabase, add users and roles, load data, apply permissions, and prepare data for multi-user versioned editing. So I've already started this script. The stuff in the beginning here we saw in our last demo, and I'm just going to show how we can add to that. So again, we're providing some variables. So we're going to use these throughout the script. So what we did so far, we created an enterprise geodatabase. We've created a connection to that geodatabase as the DBA user. We've created some roles. This time we created a viewer's role and an editor's role. And now we're ready to create some users. So the reason I wanted to pause here is here I'm creating users a little bit differently. Instead of using a Python dictionary, I'm using lists. So I have editors and I have viewers. I'm going to loop through those lists and create users using the create database user tool. I wanted to point out that this, if you are using operating system authenticated users and you're creating those users, this is an easier way to create those users instead of using a Python dictionary, since you don't have to pass in the password. So we've created those users and assigned them to the editors or viewers role. And now we're going to create a user named GDB, and that's going to be our data owner. Now that we've created that user, let's go ahead and create a connection. So now that we've created a connection as a data owner, we're going to go ahead and load data. So to do this, I'm using import XML workspace document tool. And I'm passing in my owner connection. I have XML document that I've already prepared. And we're importing the schema only, just to be a little quicker for demo purposes. So it's taking some time. So now that we've loaded our data, we want to build a list of feature classes, tables, and feature data sets in that geodatabase. So we're setting the workspace, and then we're going to use list tables, list feature classes, and list data sets to get a list of items that we just loaded. So that should take a little time because there are a few things in there. Okay, so if we were to hover over here, we can see all those feature classes that we've created. So next, now that we have our data in there, we want to set the appropriate permissions on the data. So I'm using the change privileges tool. I'm passing in that list of data, and we're going to grant all users in the viewer's role select privileges so they can query the data. And then I'm running the same tool, passing in the data list, and I'm going to grant full editing privileges to our editors. Next, I want to register the data as versioned. So we have that same data list, and I'm going to loop through and run the register as version tool and pass in that data set. So that'll loop through each of those tables and register as versioned. The last thing I want to do is, now that our data is ready for editing, I want to create a private version for each user in the editor role. So we're reusing that list we had above. We're going to loop through that list, create a connection to the geodatabase as that user, and then we are going to clear the workspace cache, since we're reusing that same connection file each time. And then we're going to use create version tool to create a version that is private and from the default. So Let's finish that up. We should get four versions created. So while that's finishing, let's take a look in Pro and see what we did. So in the demo2 folder, you can see our connection files were created. If I were to connect as the data owner, so that GDB user, I can right click, go to privileges, and I can see that my editors, my viewers, have the appropriate privileges that we assigned. And we also have our SDE user who has full editing privileges since the data is registered as versioned. And that's it for the second demo.
All right. Thanks, Jill.
In the next set of slides, let's just talk about versioning administrative workflows. Now we're wearing a different hat. But before we get there, talking about user connections. First, let's talk about why we might want to disconnect users, right? Maybe you have some users that are connected to your geodatabase and they've gone home for the day, and you have locks on your data, and you have the data owner that needs to do some schema changes. Or maybe you're the DBA who needs to perform some maintenance on the server. Sometimes you also have large queries that will take up a lot of resources, and you don't want these additional connections lying around there. So these are cases where you would want to disconnect users. We have multiple functions for managing user connections. First is the accept connection function, where you provide an admin connection and a Boolean value as parameter. True means you are, the geodatabase is accepting connections. And false means you are going to block. But when you turn that parameter to false, it does not disconnect connections immediately. Existing sessions will continue to work. It is when a new connection is created that they will get an error saying that the geodatabase is not accepting connections. The second function is the list users function. This will return information that you can ask questions, right? You ask a question about who is connected currently to the geodatabase. Finally, the last function we have is the disconnect user function. This will allow you to disconnect users from the geodatabase by passing in the ID of the user that you got from the list users. Or you can also specify all and just disconnect everyone, but I don't think that's a good idea. Are many of you here in environments where you are constantly publishing services? Show of hands. Okay, some of you. So over the years, we're seeing that as an increasing trend where many of us are now, all our data is now being published as services. So in this case, the geodatabase does not treat the feature service user any differently than any other user. To the geodatabase, the feature service user is just another user. So if you disconnect everyone from the geodatabase, this will include any of those service user connections. And that ArcGIS server has logic to keep pinging back and check if the connection is valid. So in those cases, the steps we would recommend is to first block connections to your geodatabase, stop your service, perform your whatever admin operation you have, accept connections, and start the service. That's just a clean workflow, because if you leave it, if you do not stop the service or block connections, you'll start seeing strange behavior, you know, failed queries, some things are being rendered, some are not. So that would be an ideal workflow to include in what you have. While we're talking about connections, I'd also like to bring to your attention this update enterprise geodatabase license tool. So till now I was talking about how you can disconnect user, and this is a case where, you know, if you are an ELA license where your server license expires on a certain day, here you can be as a DBA proactive, as a geodatabase administrator, and run this tool even before the license expires so that users don't get disconnected from their connection. This tool will update the license to the next expired date. Let's see another quick demo from Jill on how to handle connections.
Okay, so in this demo, we are back in Jupyter Notebooks, and I'm gonna show you some of the functions that Annie just talked about. So let's get started. So first, what we wanna do, of course, is import ArcPy. Instead of creating a new connection to the geodatabase, I've already created one, and I'm gonna assign the variable here. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're going to use accept connections. We're gonna pass in our geodatabase admin credentials, and we're gonna set that value to false. So if I were to open Pro and connect as a new user, you'll see that we'll get an error. The geodatabase is not accepting connections. However, we're not disconnecting anyone who is currently connected. So let's take a look and see who is still connected to the geodatabase. So to do that, we're going to use the list users function, and we're going to pass in our geodatabase admin credentials. So as you can see, a ton of information provided here. We have, you know, the client name, the connection date and time, the username and the user ID. Let's clean that up a little bit. It's a little bit hard to read. So I'm going to loop through that whole thing. I'm going to pull out just the username and the user ID. So we can see we have Brent, Colin, and Craig connected, as well as a feature server user and SDE user. The SDE user is our own connection. So I happen to know that Brent is gone home for the day. He probably just accidentally left something open. I feel pretty safe in disconnecting Brent. I trust him. So I'm going to go ahead and use disconnect user, pass in my geodatabase admin credentials, and then I need to provide Brent's ID. So I do want to note that if you guys are using this, the ID changes every time you can make a new connection. So it's kind of hard to hard code these things. You'd have to look it up each time. Let's run that. We'll regenerate the list to see who's still connected. And you can see that we've disconnected Brent. So as Annie was mentioning, if you guys are using any ArcGIS server feature services that are published by reference, we can't tell the difference between a regular database user and a feature server user. So in this case, I happen to know about my organization. I know that my feature server user is the user that is used to publish my feature services. So one way to go about doing this is if you want to avoid disconnecting that user, you can just use a list comprehension to kind of skip over that user. So that's what we're gonna do here. So in the list to disconnect, I wanna loop through my user list, and I wanna avoid disconnecting the SDE user, which is our own connection, and the feature server user. So it's pulled out those two IDs of Colin and Craig, and we're gonna disconnect those users. So we'll regenerate that list and see that it's only feature server and SDE that's still connected. So now I would go ahead and do all of my geodatabase tasks. And then when I'm finished, you wanna remember to set accept connections to true again, otherwise your users won't be able to connect to the geodatabase. So that was one example of how we can kind of skip over that feature server user. In our next demo, I'm going to take a look at how we can actually stop our feature services. And back to Annie.
Thanks, Jill. So continuing with the geodatabase admin workflows, we will start talking about what is our role with version management. We will talk about the whole reconcile. I'm going backwards. I meant to go forward. So in simple terms, right, reconcile and post is a process of where you push your edits between versions and it goes down to the default. And then when you do your compress, those edits go from the default to the underlying tables. We do have a reconcile versions tool which can be used to automate this process. We do recommend that you run this tool as a geodatabase administrator in an automated maintenance routine, simply because this user, as I mentioned below, before, can see all the versions and they have access to all your data. And it just makes it easier to write a script in that setup. The geodatabase admin also is a person responsible to compress your geodatabase on a regular basis. We've always recommended that you update your statistics after you do a reconcile operation. This also holds true for any major data changes that you have on your data. If you're appending a lot of data or performing a lot of edits, it's a good idea to update your statistics and indexes to ensure that your geodatabase is performing well. This can be done by the geodatabase administrator to update the statistics on your system tables, especially after the reconcile and post, but it's also to be done by the data owner on the data they own. Now, that being said, newer versions of the database platforms have excellent inbuilt mechanism to detect if statistics and indexes are stale, and they also do a rebuild. So it would be best to work with your database administrator to find out, you know, to kind of get a report of stale indexes or stale statistics, and then make a decision if you need to run statistics or indexes on your data. Let's come back to Joe to show how to do version management through Python.
Okay, so in this final demo, I've written a Python script that's gonna reconcile, post and compress, rebuild indexes, update statistics. We're gonna start and stop our feature services and then send some email reports. So I've already started here. At the top, again, we're importing our required modules. So here, we're not just using ArcPy, we're using a few other things that Python has built in. So there's no special install for these, you just import those modules. I won't go into detail about these, but we'll see those as we step through. I've also defined a number of helper functions here that I'm gonna use throughout the script, and we'll take a look at those as we step through the script. So as I mentioned, we're going to start and stop our feature services, and we're gonna do that using the ArcGIS Server REST Admin API. So we're just gonna send some GET and POST requests to start and stop those services and get information about our services. So since we're doing that, we do need to provide the server-based URL, so just the path to our server. We also need to provide the server admin and the server admin password. So now we want to connect to our geodatabase. Again, I've already created my connection as the admin user. I'm setting a few workspace environment variables. And here I have a couple Booleans at the top to determine whether I want to update statistics and indexes on my data. As Annie mentioned, you might not need to do this. Kind of every geodatabase is set up differently. So if you do want to use the script, you could set these to false if you're finding you're not needing to use these things. In this case, I'm going to set them to true so we can take a look at those tools. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to block any new connections to the geodatabase. We're going to get a list of users that are currently connected to the geodatabase. In this case, I have hard-coded my email list just to myself for demo purposes, but if you guys were to use this, you could just have a lookup table to know what geodatabase user corresponds to what email address, and you could add that here. So the first thing we want to do is we want to send an email that maintenance is going to be performed in 15 minutes, so to finish up your work. That email should come through, although I've been having some trouble today with network, so I can show you what it would look like if it doesn't pop up. So instead of making you guys wait for 15 minutes, let's go ahead and get started. So the first thing we want to do with feature services is we want to get a list of the feature services that we need to stop. So let's take a look at that function. So I've created a function get feature services. We have an empty list that we are going to append each feature service to. Next, I'm building a URL to get the list of feature services, or the list of services on my server. So that's just going to send a request to my admin API. It's going to get a list of all services. I need to provide a token to do that. And then I'm going to make that request. So basically what we did, we sent a request to the server, and now we have information about all of the services that we have on our feature server. So we want to loop through that response. We want to find all services and then figure out if it's a feature server or not. So the reason why I'm putting this filter in here is that I don't want to stop every single service. A lot of my map services aren't going to be affected by this, so I don't need to take the whole server down. So what that did is it returned a list of feature servers. If I hover it over here, we should see I have three feature services on my server. So now that we have that list of services we want to stop, let's go ahead and stop them. So again, I have another function. It's called start-stop service. We also have a URL that we're building to send to the REST admin API, and we're going to pass in the stop option. Again, we need to get a token. And then we're going to make that request. So this request is just going to stop the service that I'm passing in. When we get a response, oh, we skipped past that part, sorry. When we get a response, basically just checks the JSON and make sure that the success, it stopped the service successfully. And now we're looping through each of the services and stopping them. You've probably noticed already I have, it's kind of small, I wasn't able to zoom in for some reason, but I do have print statements kind of following the workflow as I go. So now we've stopped all of our services, we can safely go ahead and disconnect all users. So instead of providing a certain ID, I'm going to use the all keyword and disconnect all users. So now that everyone is off the geodatabase, I want to reconcile and post my versions. So first I need to get a list of versions in my geodatabase. So I'm going to use the list versions function, and I'm passing in my admin connection. And the reason I'm passing my admin connection is the admin user has access to all the versions in the geodatabase, so I can easily get a list. Then I'm using a list comprehension here so that I can get only the versions where the parent is the default version. So now that we have our list of versions, we're going to go ahead and run the reconcile versions tool with our admin credentials, and we're going to reconcile all versions. So you notice I'm passing in my version list, and I have some parameters specified here. Sorry. So these parameters just deal with, if I were to have any conflicts, I'm telling the tool how to deal with those conflicts. And I am also creating a log file here so that we can see if there were any issues, and we're going to append that to an email report. So now that our reconcile and post is finished, we're going to run a compress. Then we're going to check those Boolean values I mentioned in the beginning. So this is whether we want to run update statistics and rebuild indexes on the system tables. In this case, we do. So we're going to run rebuild indexes. We're going to pass in our admin credentials, and we're going to pass in this system parameter, meaning to run this tool on the system table, so those geodatabase repository tables. Next, we're going to update statistics. Again, we're passing in our admin connection and choosing to run on the system tables. So analyze data sets is going to update statistics on those tables. So now we're finished the tasks as our as the admin user. We're going to allow users to connect again. So now that users are allowed to connect again, let's go ahead and start up those feature services. So this is just running the exact same script that we looked at before. Instead of passing in stop, now it's going to pass in start, which is a slightly different request. But as you can see, it's looping through and starting those services again. Okay. So now that our services are up, it's time to do a few things as the data owner, so as that GDB user. So the first thing that we want to do is use the describe function. Since are many of you familiar with using ArcPy describe? A few people? Okay. So it's really useful If you have any dynamic scripts or tools that have an input SD connection file, and you don't know what the connected user is or the database or any information about it, you can use Describe to get some of those properties and use it in your script. So we're going to pass that connection in, and we want to get the username, so we're going to get connection properties.user, and that returns the user GDB. And the reason why we want to do that is we're going to build a data list again, so we're using list tables and list feature classes, but this time we want to filter by username. So we're only going to get the tables and feature classes that that user owns. With enterprise geodatabases, if I had permissions on another user's table, these functions would return those tables. So if I'm trying to do any admin tasks and passing those tables in that I do not own, I would get an error in my tool. So now that we have our data list, we can go ahead and rebuild indexes. This time we're passing in our owner connection. We're not running it on the system tables, we're passing in our data list. So that will rebuild indexes on all of those data tables. And then we're going to update statistics using analyzed data sets. So again, passing in the owner connection and our data list. So as I've been running this, I've been collecting messages as I go, and that's because I'm going to send myself an email report. So I'm going to go ahead and send that. That, again, is using a built-in Python module, smtplib. Since my other one, I can see that I got mail, but it didn't pop up there. I'm just going to show you what this would look like. So that first email I sent myself, this is the message it would look like, saying that the maintenance is going to be performed in 15 minutes, and these are the connected users. The second email shows the work that we just did in that script there. So we stopped our services, we reconciled and posted successfully. Here's our reconcile log, and it just made sure everything else ran. So this is really great. I could sit here and automate it. I could press a button and, you know, instead of having to click around, I can kind of document what I did. I can see reports. But the great thing about Python is that you can truly automate it by running it while you're not even in the office. So on Windows, I can use Task Scheduler. I think if you're on Linux, it's called a cron job, or there's a similar type scheduler. So what I want to do is I want to create a basic task. And for this basic task, I'm going to call it run reconcile. I want to run it weekly. By weekly, I mean three times a week. If you're disconnecting users, it's a good idea to run this at a time when no one is going to be on, so you're not really kicking anyone off. So 2 a.m. What we want to do is we want to start a program. And the program we want to start is just the path to our Python executable. And the argument we want to add is just the path to our Python script. So I'm going to open the properties dialog before we complete. And I want to make sure that I check whether the user is logged on or not. More than likely, I'm not going to be logged on at 2 in the morning. So this will make sure that the script runs successfully. And I want to run with the highest privileges. So I provide my user, my password. And we can see that run reconcile has been set up to run three times a week at 2 a.m. So I don't even have to come in and run this script. It just does it automatically. And I think back to Annie to wrap up.
Right. Thank you, Jill. That was the takeaway from this session. But in summary, as you saw, the geodatabase is open to all Python developers. Just a list of other sessions that are happening tomorrow. You can take a snapshot of this and attend, just getting more and more familiar tips and tricks of Python across the platform. Give you a few seconds to take a snapshot if you're interested. Please use the events app to fill out the survey. We did incorporate this year feedback we got from last year. So we take your feedback pretty seriously. So if there's anything you really wanted to see in today's session, give us your feedback. We will evaluate that and try to put it into next year's presentation. And for all of you who have been so patient with us, this is what we promised, the URL to the slides and code. And now we are available for questions. For those of you who want to stay back, come close, talk to us. Yes.
Yes, yeah, sorry. Go ahead. So the question was, when you run the Windows scheduler, you have to be an admin user on the machine that you're running it on. And I'm not sure. I think so. No, you don't have to?
I never use this.
To be honest, I'm not sure. I have to look it up. Sorry.
Yeah. By default, we're all admins on our machine.
Yeah.
So. Yes. We have a mic coming through just so that everyone can hear.
That forgot to close out their edit session.
You might have heard part of that question. So what would happen if you try to disconnect a user while they were editing still?
Yeah.
Oh, that is a bad idea to
disconnect.
Yeah, I mean,
what if, yeah, like,
you're going to do some scheduled maintenance and a person was supposed to stop editing while.
So you mean they have an active edit session going?
Correct.
And you disconnect them. The next edit they do will fail.
Okay.
But as a DBA, you know, we both went back and forth saying, you need to know a good time when you do these kind of maintenance. We have given you a lot of tools and power to do these things, but that always goes with that disclaimer that we do it at a time where we are not disrupting workflows.
We have people that don't listen.
That's not...
Is there a way to check to see if they're in an edit session?
You can check the type of logs they have.
That's just
you can have. Yeah, you can have. Yeah, I think you'll have to kind of monitor the types of logs that they have on the state and the table, right? Like some operations will require an exclusive log, and that is a sure thing that that's an edit session going. Like a reconcile, we do need to have an exclusive log on the state to do that on the target version. Yes. Mike went back, but we'll come back to you. Yes.
Sorry.
Okay.
When you disconnected the feature services, those users, those service users, did you stop all? You stopped all services and you disconnected all users, or did you just disconnect the computer users?
So in that last was script. That I did? Okay. So what I did there was I actually went and I stopped all my services, all my feature services. So I didn't directly disconnect that user. I just stopped the service. So I guess it would have just went down.
Yeah.
Disconnect all users?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
So most of the time, the database guys just hit alter table in SQL Developer, and then my ArcGIS server logs contain a lot of schema out of date messages. Are there solutions for this in ArcPy to solve these messages?
So let me see if I got your question. Is that you have a database table that gets updated on a regular basis?
No, it's alter table, add column, or increase column size, yeah, stuff like that. So then you get this schema out of date messages when you view or try to connect to this table from ArcGIS server.
Okay. So the question is that on the underlying table has schema changes happening, but the service does not know these. What do we do? So I think the recommendation is you restart your service. I don't think you need to republish, but you need to restart the service for it to go and get this new updates, schema updates that were done. But there is no magical way to claim that to update the schema in the service. You have to kind of restart the service. Have you all tried that? That doesn't work. Correct. So the user who's viewing the service cannot really do anything, but the user that has published the service can.
So the user only has view privileges, and I'm not usually restarting should help. So maybe we'll have to take a look at, right?
Yeah, because the user that is the that has published the service, you're saying in the database they have only view privilege. Let's talk offline on that. But usually restarting the service will pick up schema updates. Yes.
Hi, this might be a question for the island. I know some people want to go, but I thought it might be helpful. I don't know. Anyway, so thank you for showing all your examples of the tools in Python in the notebooks, because it's what I'm going to have to migrate to using, and I'm familiar with those tools, the other old school way of doing it. So real quick, to frame my question, we're moving from an on-prem direct connect methodology to the cloud, and we're deploying enterprise. And we're specifically interested in using branched versioning with a versioned managed service. So this is where it might be too much, and I'm willing to go to the island. But the doc that you provided and the scripts that you provided, what I'm wanting to know is if there's additional documentation, if there's this difference. I'm assuming that you would still manage your Postgres database in like an S3 bucket with the same methodologies, the same sort of tools, whether you're doing that in the co-located environment or through a notebook in that same area. Does doing anything, does taking that enterprise versioned geodatabase and putting it as a versioned managed service have any impact on the workflows you guys just showed in your doc?
That is a very interesting question. But so when you go to the whole branch version management, the geoprocessing tools in terms of reconcile versions, right? We have enhanced these tools to accept a branch versioned service. So a branch feature service that has versioning ability, the reconcile versions tool does understand that, okay, this is a branched workspace that I'm working with. But the whole thing about the database management, once you're in the cloud, it's still the same, yeah. It's just where it is, and performance and everything is its own different ball game over there. But yeah, for purposes of what you have to do, it does not change. The tools will not change, yeah.
If you are using scripting to do this, there is one other step you would need to take if you're working with branch versioning. Okay. We have a tool that updates your SD connection file to point to the branch workspace. So you would need to add that in there when you start actually connecting to the geodatabase in a script environment.
Thank you for asking that. But for those of us who have not gone there yet, yes, that would be step one, what Jill said. When you're switching between traditional versioning workspace and branch versioning workspace in your script, you will have to switch the connection, geodatabase connection properties, that parameter, to now work with branch version. But thank you for bringing that up, yes. Anything else? We are at the island here for the rest of the hour and also tomorrow. Thank you for coming. Enjoy the rest of the evening, and thank you, Chris. He's one of our developers on our team. So please, all hard questions, go to Chris. Thank you.